And then he takes almost the sensibility of Italian horror by partnering with Dario Argento and using Goblin to score the movie and creates one of the most... I remember seeing Dawn of the Dead as a kid, not really understanding the difference between 16mm or low budget or 35mm, just thinking, this doesn't look like Star Wars. This doesn't look like Harrison Ford movies. Like, there's just something...
It looked like Dario's movies.
There's just something different about the way this movie looks, the way it sounds. Gretchen Ross, Ken Fari, like Scott Reininger, like the cast that's in it.
Oh, yeah.
And it just felt like it was really happening.
Well, it kind of goes back to what you're saying when you're watching American Werewolf, where you're like watching, like, who made this? Like a maniac? Yeah. Whenever going to see it for the first time, it was like a sold out midnight screening, maybe 1980 or something. And the crowd was so rowdy watching the movie from the... Once that guy's head exploded, it was all over. And it was like the crowd seemed dangerous, the movie seemed dangerous, the seats seemed dangerous. Everything about it seemed so
degenerate. Like you thought you were going to get stabbed.
And it ends with a biker gang taking over the mall where these people have lived.
It wasn't like, oh, it was crazy, then it mellowed. It just kept getting crazier and crazier. But at the same time, I wasn't drawn to the craziness. It was the main characters I was so into. Like, I was so in their heads, and so, like, I was trapped in that mall, and I was, you know what I mean?
No, it's sad. When he gets bit.
Crazy gore for
when he gets bit, and you know he's going to come back, and he's got to shoot his friend. I mean, that is the most overused cliche in zombie movies now, is the friend gets bit, and I'm going to, you know, in the other room, have to take him out.
All the scenes, like, when they're shopping and playing video games.
But you got to watch them have fun. It's like he took this contained world. It's interesting, you know, hearing him talk about it later, when he said that, he got the idea, he was at the mall and he just saw like a bunch of people wandering around like zombies and thought, God, after they're dead, they're just gonna come back here and shop. And this movie becomes this incredible metaphor for consumption and the phenomenon of malls that was happening at the time, and that people just wanna consume and consume and consume. That the layers of social commentary, I remember as a kid watching that movie, in the first 20 minutes, there's a SWAT team raiding a house, and one of the police officers is unbelievably racist, and is like shouting out every racial slur in the book. And I was like, why is this guy concerned with racism? Like, there's zombies in the building.
Right.
There are people coming back from the dead. Why is this guy like so concerned with taking out the Hispanics? It was unbelievable. I was like, aren't there bigger problems? It was amazing, but that's what he was going for. That's what he was infusing. And like the chaos at the television station.
The chaos at the TV station.
It was you just were like, what is this movie? And that scene in the basement where the people, they're all being kept alive.
Well, and that, hiding. I remember when I first saw it, that tenement building scene, I wasn't sure exactly what was going on, so I was kind of on edge because you see the two guys talking, and it's like, yeah, they got them all holed up in one building. And you're like, wait, why? Why are they holed up? And what did they do? What's happening? Yeah, and you think about the fact that martial law is in effect, and you're going, wait a minute, there's a zombie outbreak, and people refuse to leave. So by staying in their building, the SWAT team's like, we know better. We're going to go in and we're going to take them out. The one-legged priest who lived in Pittsburgh, and I used to see him walking up and down the street. I'd be like, so when the dead walks in your, and I was like, that's the guy, he's right there. And he goes, they still believe there's respect in dying. And when you find all the people in this building, and we realized that everybody that was in the tenement building, the reason they didn't leave is because they didn't want to leave the people that they lost. So they put their bodies in the basement. So then when Ken Foray and Scott Reininger go downstairs, there's like one zombie with like a rosary wrapped around its hand chewing on a foot.
And it's creepy, that basement. I'd never seen that level of a body count in a movie.
No.
In such different ways. Like normally one movie, there'd be one kill that was amazing. And it was like every 30 seconds, it was like, oh my God, the helicopter. Every time they stopped somewhere, each kill was different. Like that helicopter blade, pulling it off the head.
The giant forehead.
Which giant, when you were a kid, right, exactly. By the way, when you're a kid, you never see that coming. You see he staggers out and his head is this.
He's got
you never put two and two together. Now you look at it and go, oh, of course he's going to get his head cut off.
Yeah, that movie seems.
And with the blood pressure machine with the arm and the detail of the arm getting chopped off. And the blood. It's brilliant. And it was iconic. But I had just had never seen that kind of mayhem. And then when Savini comes in and acts in the movie as a biker, you're like, that's the dude who came up with this
Blade.
Stuff. And the chest being ripped open. But then I remember going to see Day of the Dead thinking, how are they going to one-up this? So what was it like?